Ever wondered how it's like being deaf? This audio experience allows you to learn more about how it's like growing up with cochlear implants. Follow along by flipping the page when you hear this sound. Chapter 1, Cochlear Implants. Hi, welcome. It's so nice to meet you. My name is Sarah, and I bet you're wondering, what's that fancy looking thing on my ear? Well, that's my cochlear implant, and it has helped me hear sound since I was young. You see, I was born profoundly deaf, and what that means is, hearing aids don't work very well on me. So, how do cochlear implants work? Unlike hearing aids, which just make sounds louder, cochlear implants replace the damaged parts of the inner ear and directly send sound signals to my brain. Pretty cool tech, isn't it? It's kind of a miracle, really. And of course, it didn't come cheap. The doctors explained to my parents about the costs of going ahead with this decision. There were risks involved in the surgery, and even after that, I had to have regular visits to the hospital with the audiologist and speech therapist to check out and improve my speech and hearing. It would be a journey that they would have to commit to for the rest of their lives. My parents agreed to it. They were determined to give me a fighting chance at integrating into the hearing world, and I'm so thankful for that. So, at the fine young age of 2, I got a surgery to get cochlear implants permanently implanted under my skin, and from my world of silence, I started to hear sound for the very first time. Chapter 2, My Deaf Accent. When I meet people for the first time, they would often ask me about my accent, and most of the time, they think that I'm from a different country. Well, that's my deaf accent. Most, if not all, people who are deaf from an early age cannot hear their voices, or they will use an aid to hear. This aid does not translate perfectly to what perfect hearing sounds like. Because of this, we hear differently, therefore, we speak a little differently. We might speak the same language, but have trouble with certain pronunciations or consonants. As a child, I went through speech therapy to improve the way that I spoke, so that when I pronounce certain words, they don't end up all jumbled. This helped a lot, even though I sometimes stumble on certain words when I speak too fast, especially when I'm excited, which kind of happened a lot. In addition to speech therapy, I wanted so badly to make sure that when I speak, I sounded normal. So I would often spend time in my room practicing my speech by taking a book and reading it out loud to myself. I took pride in being able to speak well, but when I got to high school, that changed. I was in a group project for a class and I said something. This boy, right after I spoke, mimicked the way I said it, and everyone laughed. I was humiliated, but instead of fighting back, I laughed along with them. That same boy and several others made fun of the way I spoke all throughout high school. Slowly, I started speaking less and less in social environments because I thought it was the only thing that people would notice about me. Well, I learned that I shouldn't be worried about something I have no control over. One of my friends told me, "You shouldn't worry about it. I don't notice it. To me, it's just who you are. You are not defined by it. So chill out." And you know what? She's right. It doesn't define me as long as I don't let it. Chapter 3, The Sounds That I Hear. My cochlear implant helps me to hear, but it doesn't mimic perfect hearing. And I learned that the way I hear voices and music is different from those with normal hearing. So a lot of people ask me, what is different about the way you hear? And how much of it do you hear? I'm going to let you experience those sounds today. Let's start with music. My favorite song at the moment is Airwaves by Brett Kissel. Let me play it for you.
We didn't make it more than a getaway mile. She put a pretty painted finger on the dial and got every speaker in the backseat buzzing. You could just tell that you loved it. There must be something in the airwaves.
That is how music sounds like to you. But this is how it sounds like to me. I can't tell the difference because I never grew up with normal hearing, so I have nothing to compare it to. When I let my hearing friend listen to it, she described that in the normal audio, the sound was crisp and easy to hear. She can make out what instruments were playing. In contrast, the vocoded sounds were very staticky, and you can compare it to the sound of waves crashing into the ocean. When I heard what my friend said, I found it difficult to believe because I like listening to music on my iPod. I figured that the reason why I hear this way is because technology is not able to mimic perfect hearing. Well, it doesn't really matter to me because music makes me happy. Listening to my favorite songs gets me into a good mood, and I love bobbing to the beat of it. Here's a playlist of the songs that I like to listen to. Maybe you could give it a listen and see if you like it. That would be pretty cool because we'd be listening to different versions of the same song and bonded by our love for it. Okay, let's move on to the voices. Right now, what you're hearing, that's what normal hearing sounds like. But this is what I hear. Could you catch what I said? I said, does my voice sound like it's underwater right now? Bloop, 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 I'm a fish. Do you think so? Well, maybe then you'll understand that I can't hear too well, especially when people are talking at the same time. That was just one voice. What about hearing it in a noisier setting? So, in class, it's probably easy for you to focus on the teacher's voice.
Everything in this world is made up of matter, and those matters behave with each other in certain ways. And that, students, is chemistry.
For me, this is what I hear without the use of an FM system.
Everything in this world knows different matters, behaves amongst each other.
I tend to find places noisier than most of my hearing friends. In a class, I can hear the whirring of the fans, the dragging of feet, the teacher yelling, and sometimes it gets overwhelming for me. My implant is unable to block out background noise and focus on the certain sounds like your ears can. So sometimes when it gets too noisy, I may turn off my implants to enjoy the silence for a while. I think it's pretty cool how I can do that. Of course, there were times I wish I could have had perfect hearing. That way, I would have had lesser challenges to overcome. I'll be able to use the phone whenever I want and do things like schedule appointments or make calls to friends on my own. But I'm not complaining because at least I have the privilege of being able to hear something. My hearing's not perfect, but it's helped me in so many ways, and I'm proud of how far I've come. Chapter 4, Listening with My Eyes. For you, hearing is easy, but for me, my ears are my weakest asset. Even with the cochlear implant, I actually miss out on a lot of the sounds that people say, so I rely on lip reading to figure out the words that I miss out. Lip reading becomes really helpful in loud atmospheres like bars, clubs, malls, or any place that usually has a lot of noise. It's great, but it's not always foolproof because a lot of the letters actually take the same lip shape. For an example, try saying fish followed by dish into a mirror and repeat that. Doesn't it look kind of the same? So, lip reading takes a lot of skill and practice, and not all deaf people can lip read. But let me tell you, once you've mastered this skill, you can use it to spy on other people's conversations. It's the most entertaining thing ever. The funniest conversation that I overheard, so to speak, happened when I was studying at a cafe near my school. Here's how it went down. A woman came into the shop, and as soon as she steps in, a man greets her. They take a seat a few meters away from my table, grabbed a coffee, and started chatting for quite a bit. They looked like they were having a good time. So after about 10 minutes of them talking, I got bored of studying, and I decided to tune in my eyes to their conversation. The lady says, "I can't believe it's been so long. About 20 years? I'm really glad that we caught up today." And the man says, "Yeah, me too. We could meet for coffee next week again, if you like." She then says, "Sure, I'd love to. Maybe your sister can join us too. I'd love to meet her again." There was an awkward pause, and the man says, "Wait, I don't have a sister." At that point, both of their faces were priceless. The woman goes, "Wait a minute. Your name is Pete, right?" He responds, no. "Is your name Karen?" So this whole time, they were talking to a complete stranger about the last 20 years of their lives. This was the part where I became a total embarrassment. I couldn't contain myself, and I just burst out laughing. So I was sitting there laughing by myself, staring at my laptop. You know, completely normal. So I finally calm down, and I look up. Both of them were staring right at me from across the cafe. I quickly grabbed my phone and pretended that I was laughing at a really funny conversation that my friend just sent me. So, lip reading can actually be a lot of fun. It also helps me in social settings by allowing me to communicate with my peers better. I can safely say that if I didn't know how to lip read, I wouldn't be as socially outgoing as I am today. If you want to be as skilled as me, here are two pieces of advice. First, take some classes and practice whenever you can. Secondly, because eavesdropping by ear is way more subtle than just staring at a person, I would advise you to bring sunglasses, the ones with the dark shades. No, seriously, you can get away with a lot if you wear them. Give it a try with your friends and let me know how it goes. It's fun, I promise. Chapter 5, Being a Friend. If you ever do meet someone who wears cochlear implants, don't be afraid to ask them if you have any questions. The best thing that you can do is to be a friend to them. Treat them like you would treat anyone else. Also, make sure to look at them when you're speaking. I have some advice on hanging out with people like me. Like I mentioned, when I go out with my hearing friends to places like restaurants or bars that are a little noisy, it does take a lot more effort for me to follow the conversation with both my sight and hearing abilities. Sometimes, when people talk too fast, I won't be able to catch it. But my friends always make it a point to make me feel included. And whenever I ask them to, they would patiently repeat to me what I had missed. This means a lot, because I really do want to be a part of the conversation. So, when my group of friends noticed that I had trouble listening in certain settings, they suggested to have dinner and games at my place instead, and so they did. You can't imagine how much better it was for me, because I could focus and engage a lot more with my friends without having to fight with the background noise. Ever since then, it's become a weekly thing for my friends to come over to my place on Friday nights. We play all sorts of things, cards, Jenga, or console games, and they're so much fun. I guess the lesson is, there are many different ways that we can go about socializing, and a small action does go a long way. I can't thank my friends and family enough for being so patient with me. Thank you for taking the time to listen to our story. It means the world to us that you would take this first step in wanting to understand more about us. This project is dedicated to Chomaine and Jomaine. Thank you for letting me learn more about your world. It's been such a privilege getting to know the both of you. And a special thanks to Karina Coltrane. Without her, this project would not have been possible. Most of the stories here were adapted from her book, Hearing Differently, as well as her podcast. I am also honored to have her as the voiceover for this book. We hope that you've gained as much as we have from this experience.